cash might be one of the most underutilized and underrated pieces to a successful financial plan in the modern day. They give the holders almost no returns whatsoever, and nowadays are actually losing value relative to inflation on a fairly consistent basis. And in terms of providing diversification to a portfolio or hedging one's bet, they tend not to be the first asset that people turn to. However, despite their low to non-existent returns, less than ideal diversifying abilities, and lack of appeal as hedges, I believe that there are still incredibly good reasons why cash should be part of all of our financial plans. Today, I'm going to be going over three reasons why I feel that we should all have a cash buffer. But before we get going, be sure to like this video if you haven't already, as it really does help out the channel a lot, and subscribe with notifications on for more money-related videos like this one every single week. And if you want to further support this channel, you can check out some of the links I've left in the description below, which includes a link to my Patreon page. This is the best way to show your support for this channel, and in addition to that, you can also get early access to new videos and exclusive content such as spreadsheets based off the ideas we discuss in these videos. The spreadsheets will allow you to play with your own numbers and see how big of a difference some of the ideas we discuss can make for your own personal financial situation. Now, to be clear, when I say a cash buffer, I mean some cash put away in addition to the traditional 3 to 6 month emergency fund. I think we all understand the benefits of having an emergency fund, but that's not what I'm talking about today. I'm talking about having some cash in addition to that. So the first reason I feel everyone should have a cash buffer is that, similar to having an emergency fund, it can further lower stress levels. Not to mention the problems that can often spring from them, such as having health problems, relationship issues, depression, and just general discontent, as well as increasing financial freedom and spontaneity. Lowering stress will not only bring with it an immediate quality of life improvement, and probably some lower overall healthcare costs in the long run, especially considering that stress is often linked to many of the most common health issues, and money is often cited as one of, if not the biggest, stressors in many people's lives, but there's a chance that it may also impact your spending in the short run. Some studies have shown that those who are undergoing significant amounts of stress tend to spend more money and make more spending decisions emotionally than those who aren't dealing with those same levels of stress. It's often referred to as emotional or impulse spending. This obviously has more noticeable benefits on some of us than others for a wide variety of reasons, some of which we're still learning about, but those who do engage in this type of spending behavior also tend to be less happy on average with their purchases over time than those who made their spending decisions in a more calm manner. The reason for this seems to be that the spending decisions that are made when we are stressed are often made in order to ease that emotional roller coaster in the here and now, as opposed to promoting long-term satisfaction. And as a result, after the emotional episode has passed, the things that we bought hold significantly less value to us. Now, having a cash buffer isn't going to remove the emotional ups and downs from our lives, just like having an emergency fund doesn't completely remove them, but it might help to make the ups and downs that spring from financially related events, such as worries about one's job security, the economy, and our investment performance, or unexpected bills that come up from time to time, less intense, which can help make it easier for us to avoid those impulse purchases because we won't feel like we're on such a wild roller coaster ride. But beyond that, I feel having this additional cash buffer can help us to be a little freer, more spontaneous, and even better communicators when it comes to our money and our budgets. This is because if you have the cash on hand to cover things like a furnace breaking down or having to fix something on a car, then you'll be able to put more of your ongoing income towards other things like your investments, a date night, or a vacation fund. This same freer, more relaxed feeling towards conscious spending can also make it easier for you or your partner to express their financial goals and dreams without fearing that it'll lead to some sort of argument or other kind of conflict. And as you can imagine, being able to be a little more open and flexible with your money and the communication around it can also help to head off some of the financially related relationship issues that sometimes spring up when one person in the relationship starts to be viewed as a bit of a tightwad by the other. For the record, money issues are often also cited as one of the leading factors for divorce. So if having an additional cash buffer can help us to head off some of those financially related relationship issues, it's quite a big deal. The second reason that I feel everyone should have a cash buffer is that lacking one can lead to you moving backwards financially if something should go wrong, such as a job loss or an over-leveraged investment going awry and/or medical or other emergencies. Simply put, if you find yourself in a situation where you have to start taking on debt as a result of this lack of cash, you'll probably find yourself paying for it in more ways than one. Obviously, there's the direct monetary cost of having debt in the form of interest payments, but there's also the cost associated with time and opportunity. If your hard-earned cash is going towards paying off debts, then you may be unable to take advantage of one of the greatest investment opportunities of all, which is buying the market dip during an economic crisis, which, incidentally, also tends to be the most common time when lacking a cash cushion bites you in the butt. For instance, let's say that from 1928 through 2020, John had $500 a month to invest, and in most years, he invested all of it in the S&P 500. However, in the years where the economy and the markets were not doing well, he wasn't investing anything, because he was afraid of having to use the money from his, suddenly very volatile, investments to put food on the table. We'll say that in any year where the markets were down at least 20% below their all-time highs, John didn't invest, and in all other years, he invested that consistent $500 a month. Based on that, he would have ended up with a net worth of around $390.64 million, with a total of $486,000 being invested out of his own pocket. Now, let's look at Jane, who invests less money each month than John, but due to having that cash buffer, she's never worried about moving backwards financially. Therefore, she feels comfortable investing consistently regardless of whatever the markets are doing. We'll say that she's putting away $300 a month. What do you suppose her ending net worth will be by the end of 2020? The answer is $481.4 million, with $338,400 of that being money that Jane invested out of her own pocket. So both John and Jane invested during the same time period. So this isn't one of those compound interest examples where one person started young and so the other person was never able to catch up financially. They're on even footing, at least in terms of timing. John actually invested more overall, $486,000 versus Jane's $338,400. So in theory, he should have the leg up, but he comes up short by over $90 million. Why is that? It's because he wasn't able to take advantage of buying the market dips like Jane did. For the record, in case you were wondering, if Jane had invested the same $486,000 as John, she would have wound up with over $691.4 million. That's roughly 77% more than John over the same time period with the same amount of money invested. That's how much of a difference buying the dip can make over time. As always, if you want to explore different scenarios with your own numbers, I've got a spreadsheet up on my Patreon page called The Power of Buying the Dip that allows you to select different portfolios and time periods, put in how much money you've got and how much you're going to invest both during normal years and during dips, which you can also set custom thresholds for if you don't want to use the 20% like I just did. But for the purposes of today's video, the point is it can make quite a difference, especially with those more volatile and high reward investments like stocks. And if having that cash buffer makes you more comfortable investing during the good times and the rocky ones, then that's probably a pretty darn good investment to make, even though the cash itself doesn't give you much of a return at all. It's those ancillary effects that are so often missed but can be oh so important for long-term success. Beyond investing, you could also miss out on other opportunities such as starting a side hustle if you don't have cash on hand when you need it. This could lead to having a lower income, not to mention less income streams overall, which can make you more vulnerable to outside shocks in the first place, such as job losses. A third reason why I believe everyone should have a cash buffer is one that doesn't often get talked about, and it's that having a cash buffer to fall back on during market turbulence allows you to increase your safe withdrawal rate and improve your overall financial independence income metrics, in some cases by as much as 3-5%, because you're less likely to have to sell your investments when they're down to generate that income you need to maintain your lifestyle during financial independence. Now, this may not be an earth-shattering difference, but when we're dealing with goals as large as fire, every little bit helps. Here's an example to show you how this works. Let's say that John was just about to pull the trigger for fire. He's got $1 million in an S&P 500 index fund and no cash buffer, beyond his emergency fund, of course, because we should all still have that. What would his safe withdrawal rate be? Well, at least based off the data I have going back to 1927, it would be about 3.45% before taxes and expenses. Though that figure is based on the yearly return data, so it may not capture all the granular outcomes of investing in the exact month or the exact day that a market peaked before a major downturn. So consider it an estimate based off of historical data, rather than an absolute truth. But for the purposes of illustrating the difference between having an additional cash buffer and not, an estimate like this will serve us just fine. So 3.45% without a cash buffer is the initial bar. That's $34,500 a year in income to start. What if John had actually had a cash cushion? Let's say that similar to what we see with people using a three-bucket approach, John had a 2-3 year cash cushion that he could fall back on to cover his expenses when his investments are down. We'll say that in the first example, he has a $70,000 cash cushion, earning 2% interest, and in the second example, a $100,000 cash cushion, again, earning 2% interest. He'll use the cushion to cover his expenses whenever his investments are at least 20% below all-time highs. If we run a simulation testing every starting year between 1927 and 1991, the last year for which we could get a full 30-year retirement period as of this writing, we see that with a 2-year cash cushion, the minimum safe withdrawal rate for that same asset allocation jumps from 3.45% to 3.8%. With the 3-year cushion, it rises to 3.93%. which incidentally puts it basically on par with the classic 60-40 strategy in this regard, except that the average, median, and maximum withdrawal rates of the S&P 500 approach are considerably higher than a classic 60-40 strategy. So again, not an earth-shattering difference, but a noticeable one. And there are the ancillary benefits of being able to reach financial independence faster when your safe withdrawal rate is higher. I mean, if John wanted to live on $50,000 a year, he'd need to put away nearly $1.45 million using the figures that we just had, assuming he had no cash cushion. But if he had a $70,000 cash cushion, either because he saved it up himself or just waited a few extra months for his investments to appreciate at the very end of the cycle, to build up that cash cushion, he would only need a bit over $1.3 million. With a $100,000 cash cushion, he'd only need about $1.27 million. That's a near $180,000 difference in required savings for having a $100,000 cash cushion, which I'd imagine for most people is more than they would need to cover like 2 or 3 years worth of bare minimum expenses. And that to me sounds like a pretty good use of money, especially considering the other benefits that come along with having some extra cash on hand. So those are some reasons why I believe having some extra cash on hand can be beneficial. It can help to further lower stress levels and the chances that we'll find ourselves moving backward financially at some point. It can make us more open to spontaneous expenses that we'll actually enjoy. It can help to make open and honest communication around money between partners a little easier, thus hopefully increasing the chances of both people realizing their financially related dreams, as well as heading off some issues that might have otherwise developed under a more closed-door communication style. And it can also allow us to take advantage of any opportunities that may come up, be it a market dip, a business venture, or something else entirely. And finally, it can help make achieving financial independence easier while improving the lifestyle our nest egg will be able to support after we've made the transition. This is especially true if having a cash cushion allows us to shift to a more high-risk, high-reward allocation, because as we just saw, something like the S&P 500 combined with a cash cushion can be roughly as safe in the worst-case scenario as a classic 60-40 strategy. But in anything except the worst-case scenarios, the all-stock approach of the S&P 500 will generally have a much higher ceiling. But what do you think? Does having some extra cash on hand still play a role in achieving success financially and otherwise? Or do you believe that cash is trash, as the old saying goes, due to its low to non-existent returns in the modern day? Let me know in the comments section below. But that'll do it for me today. Once again, if you enjoyed this video, be sure to smash that like button if you haven't already, subscribe, and hit that bell next to my name so you'll be notified of all my future uploads. I generally upload every single Monday, and if you have a friend that would be interested in this kind of content, be sure to share it with them. Let's really get this information out there and start our own financial revolution.